Two words. I have two words.
Cairo Santos.
You guys know who that is? He's the guy that missed four field goals. Four, not three, four field goals today. If the Titans do not cut this man by tonight, if on my Twitter feed, if on my ESPN feed, I do not see Tennessee Titans have released kicker Cairo Santos, I would rather watch a team of 11 pigeons on the field compete next Sunday than the Tennessee Titans. Oh, I am pissed. Nah, I think a god dang actual rabbit, a freaking rabbit, could have kicked more accurate field goals than him. If it's 30 yards, it was short. An NFL kicker was short on a 30-yard field goal. Mike Vrabel, after this guy just was short on a 30-yard field goal, decides to try and attempt a 53-yard field goal with Cairo Santos. Dude, the guy couldn't make a field goal from the length of my dome. Which, that's not very far. That's not far at all. And you elect, when you're in the thick of things with 5 minutes left to go, to kick a 53-yard field goal. That's the kind of decision that pissed me off. All in all, I'm okay with the Titans. What I'm not okay with is goddamn Cairo Santos and Mike Vrabel's idiotic junior high type decision to try to kick a 53-yard field goal with a kicker who missed it from the length of my dome. I said, dude, go change your bet right now because this team. I wish I was a fan of cricket and not this team. Jesus Christ, every week it's something to piss me off. 53-yard field goal attempt when the guy was short on a 30-yard field goal. What are you doing, Mike Vrabel? Rip your heart out every single year. I would rather be a fan of cricket. I honest to God would. Four missed field goal. Like, I don't understand this. I hope we actually sign a pigeon to a contract. What the hell makes them think Cairo Santos in that position after missing three field goals can make a 53-yarder? Hopefully, he gets fired and he becomes a chef. That, I think, at this point would be the only thing that can make my day better. Cairo Santos, I don't like him.
And that's how you do a cold open. Welcome back to the 716 Sports Podcast here, recording live on a Monday night, the week of October 7th. For the first time here of the season, we got Bills and Sabres regular season action to talk about. That's exciting. The Sabres game is wrapping up here right now, so we're going to start with some football. And guys, finally, after what feels like many discussions are long, National Nightmare is finally over. Finally, Zay Jones is no longer a member of the Buffalo Bills, traded here just a little bit ago to the Oakland Raiders for a fifth-round pick. I feel like at this point, we would be in agreement that basically any kind of value you could get from that and salvage something. It was a pick that looked pretty good at the time, but a player who has not lived up to any single bit of his hype or expectations and was easily replaced on Sunday with very little hitch, and now goes out to the great Golden Coast with Nathan Peterman to try to rekindle that magic.
Yes. Temporarily, and then he gets to play the slots in Vegas all day and all night. Yeah, it was anybody that's disappointed by the turnout obviously hasn't been paying attention. The guy has under 100 yards receiving this season. He was on the field.
Not in a game this whole season.
For the entire season. That's five games. Duke Johnson instantly calls up from the practice squad, gets the second most snaps of any wideout on the team.
And he caught the ball.
Yeah, he caught the ball. He had a touchdown. He had the game-winning touchdown reception. Good for Duke. And, yeah, you can't offer the versatility by being able to play on special teams. And, yeah, it's over for Zay. It certainly was a pick that I liked at the time. Seemed like a guy that could be potentially a building block. It just never happened, and he never really was able to translate his amazing skills that he showed in college. You know, he was a catching machine. Really, the offense for East Carolina is final season there, and now he is once again a wasted high round pick for the Bills.
And who would have thought those classes at Nelson Aguilar's school for wide receivers who want to catch the football and be good at other stuff too wouldn't have paid out when he came to the NFL? Really seemed to forget everything he learned at ECU about catching the football, and it's been sad to see the quick downward spiral. And he had that one promising season that looked like it got derailed by injury, and then you had the offseason incident, and it's been just tough. And I think the best case for both the player and the team in this situation is for them both to move on. For Zay to get a new start in Oakland.
And if he does well, good. Good for him. There was no way that you were going to get a fifth-round pick in the 2021 draft is all you can ask for at this point. Sunk costs, you pick him for a two to get a five out of him for a guy that will absolutely have been a cap casualty just an outright cut, not even a cap casualty, he would have been cut next year. Mm-hmm. No doubt in my mind he was not a part of the future, and so he's gone. There's what he will always be was potential, and he just never lived up to it. And sometimes that happens in the NFL. Happens a lot more than we realize, I think. And that's the end of it. So, c'est la vie, Zay Jones.
Now on to the game that we mentioned a few snippets from. Now, the Bills won a football game. It wasn't great. It wasn't exciting. It wasn't pretty. But at the end of the day, they go to Nashville, Tennessee, with a huge legion of traveling Bills fans. In a rainy game, they get the job done. 14-7 victory over the Titans, aided in part by some interesting kicking and some interesting kicking decisions by Mike Vrabel and Cairo Santos, the now former kicker for the Tennessee Titans, I'm sure, by the time you're listening to this. They're trying out Cody Parkey, which tells you everything you need to know about their kicking situation.
Oh, yeah, he's already been released.
Well, there you go. So by the time we're recording this, he's already gone. Even better. I knew I was right. But I don't know, and this might just be me. And it's maybe because I analyze the Bills more than I think about any other NFL team. In spite of the 4-1 record, which is great, and the games ahead of them that they have, which are very winnable, which is the Dolphins twice, a game against the 0-5 Redskins who just fired their coach, another game against the Jets, a game against the Broncos team that's 1-4, plus others. There's just nothing. I think if your opinion of the Bills going into yesterday's game was they're going to be a team that can maybe win a playoff game, I don't think that changed your opinion. But I think if you went to yesterday's game with a opinion of, I'm not sure what the Buffalo Bills are, I don't think anything happened yesterday that changes your mind about whether or not this team can actually compete with the top teams in the AFC at this point.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's hard to tell. It's hard to tell yesterday's game everything that the Bills are just because of the fact it was a weather game. The field was wet. That had an effect on the kicking game. I think that also had a little bit of effect on both offenses. I'm thinking the Bills are missing Singletary. They don't really have that second real running back to lean on because Yeldon's not doing much. I mean, they're makeshift offensive line at the end of the game. Morris was out. Ford was out. I mean, there was a lot going against them, and they found a way to work through it.
What did you think of Josh Allen saying that was his best game he's had?
Bullshit.
I can appreciate that he was confident in his performance. I mean, considering that he was limited in practice most of the week, I don't really hate it. I'm having a hard time judging him for a week where I think up through Friday, they really weren't sure whether or not he was going to be able to play.
Late Friday, he was cleared in concussion protocol, yep. So it really wasn't until Saturday that we knew for sure that he was going to be playing.
But I would not say that was his best game. It wasn't even his best game of the season.
I still think it was the Giants game, right?
It was, yeah. And I guess I can kind of understand that, too. Was the Giants game as much of a challenge as yesterday? I think the Tennessee defense is leaps and bounds ahead of the Giants defense.
Sure. Yeah. Yes. That's a fair statement. I would agree with that. I'm just curious, that's an interesting statement for a professional athlete to come out and say, I think I played my best game today. Like that. This is just not something that you hear very frequently from someone. So that surprised me that he came out and said that. That's not something that I would expect to hear out of him.
I don't think it was egregiously bad. There was nothing outstanding.
The Bills move the ball more consistently and at a greater, I don't want to say pace, but the Bills offense looked better than the Titans offense did yesterday.
I did.
I mean, I think that, and the kind of, it, you know, when we're talking about this game holistically, once again, a superlative effort by the defense. I don't understand how. Yeah, well, I mean, the scheme is working to the point, and all the players love playing in the scheme, right? And it shows they were able to get incredible pressure.
They love
pressure.
Playing in it. They're playing well. They look like they're genuinely having fun and enjoy playing together out there. Yes. Like, the defense checks all the boxes for, like, a top defense. And now with what happens to the Bears defense yesterday in London, now, I don't know, maybe some of those London games get a little wonky, but you could argue that the Bills defense is number one or number two in the NFL at this point. It's maybe even them and the Patriots are the top two defenses in the NFL.
Yeah, I think that's a fair statement. There's very few that can compete at this point. And it is really impressive to see what the day in, day out. Now, none of these teams that they've beaten are exactly world beaters on offense too. I would say that probably, you know, actually I think statistically going into yesterday, Tennessee was the best one. They've had some up and down performances. They'll score 40 points and then they'll score less than 20. But yeah, I mean, you know, it was still a team that doesn't turn the ball over, and it was pretty efficient. They played in their place and did a really nice job.
Even though they didn't get a win out of it, I'd say New England's offense.
Yeah, and they completely shut them down too.
Right.
No, yeah, that's a great point. I think of the New England offense as what it was against Buffalo, and that's the only game where they look like that. They've been pretty efficient otherwise.
But then again, I'm also going by past history of what the Patriots have been over the last how many years with Brady and company.
Oh, yeah. But they have been, I mean, they've been great prior to that. Now, they've also played a bunch of duds, too. I mean, we talk about how bad the Bills schedule has been.
Patriots schedule has been equally bad.
Yeah, they've beaten Miami, they've beaten New York, they've beaten Washington. Three of the
only good teams that these teams have played is each other, really.
Right, so it's really hard to say. And New England won the game by 6, in which the Bills' starting quarterback was lost to injury during the game. I mean, pretty close, right?
But there's an argument to be made that this Bills team could still be competing, not just for a playoff spot, but if the offense picks itself up. I don't think the offense has been irredeemably bad. I just think that there's a lot of room for improvement on really only one side of the football. I think the defense has done about as much as you could ever hope for this defense to do, and then some.
And it just seems like I'm waiting for the day where the defense gives up 28 in a game, and I don't know.
If the defense ever gives up 21, defense gives up 3 touchdowns in a game, do we have any confidence that this offense will win that football?
Who's it going to come against? I mean, these next few games, you got Miami, who is the worst team. Philly, but Carson Wentz can't even put up 20 against Atlanta. Atlanta's one win of the year is against Philadelphia. I mean, they didn't play well yesterday.
Wentz was missing his top 4 receivers.
I understand that, but injuries and all that are still part of it too.
Sure.
Are they going to get healthy in time? I don't know. It seems like whatever they do, they can't quite get to that point. So there's a lot to be said about this Bills. But, you know, we were talking about, can they compete with a healthy Chiefs and a healthy Patriots? I don't know. I think they compete with everybody else in the AFC. And a break yesterday. The Colts winning in Kansas City was a bit of a stunner. But you had some teams fall yesterday where now the Bills are the only team not leading their own division that are at 4-1 in this conference now. They are one game clear of Oakland and Indianapolis, and everybody else is 2 games behind them. I mean, you want to talk about luck. That's pretty incredible. And right now, as we're recording, the Browns are losing to the 49ers. We'll see what comes of that.
Yeah.
But man, oh man, there's a lot going on right now that looks pretty good to say you can almost... It's really hard not to see this team getting to 10.
To build off of your point there, I'm not convinced there is any team at this point in the AFC, and that includes the 2 teams that are like considered the cream of the crop, that is absolutely untouchable for the Bills team. I mean, look at what the Colts did last night to Kansas City. They just dominated them in the trenches, wore them down, and then played...
Beat them up.
Yeah, beat them up, and then played good coverage downfield. I mean, I would trust Trey White as much as anyone to keep up with Hill or Watkins or one of those guys.
And then, but who did they lose to the week prior to that?
And they lost, Kansas City lost to Oakland.
Right. Or Indianapolis lost to Oakland.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you're talking about, you know, a team that everybody kind of thought was a bit of a joke. They were 1-2 going into that. Now they've won 2 games against Indianapolis. I mean, everybody's beating everybody. I just don't think that if the Bills can get that consistent defensive performance, they're going to win a lot more than they're going to lose.
Well, you look at their remaining schedule, and I think we mentioned it when we came back into the segment. two games against the Dolphins that you have to win because that Dolphins team is terrible. You have a game against the Redskins who have all but thrown in the towel. You have the Jets again at the end of the season, which is a game that a good team will win.
Yeah. Put it this way.
Yeah.
Can you go 3-5 against this schedule? Home against Philly, at Cleveland, home against Denver, at Dallas, home against Baltimore, at Pittsburgh, at New England, home against New York Jets.
I think there's
if you can go 3-5 against that and do what you need to do against the two games against Miami and the one against Washington, you're 10-6. I don't know how many teams are going to even get to 10-6. And you do that and you win these games in your conference and you're getting these tiebreakers. Like that Titans game was bigger than beating the Giants because now it's in conference. You eliminated essentially, you put 1.5 games between yourself and one of the teams that's contending against you.
And there's two more games like that, too, that even if you split the games with Baltimore and Cleveland, those are two other teams that are probably going to be cannibalizing each other. Mm-hmm. One of them, I think one of those teams is going to win the AFC North. And
I agree. It will be one of those teams. Absolutely.
But it'll be interesting to see where they go from here. So yesterday's game, I don't know. So it does feel a little weird to me that Josh Allen says it's his best game, to get back to your original point. I did not see anything from the offense that was great. You got the other side of having Frank Gore, which is a good defensive front, and an O-line that is still not great, and an old running back who can't really bounce outside. He did not have as good of a game as he had against New England. I think that's really an indictment of him as much as an indictment of missing that change of pace outside back in Devin Singletary, who probably won't be back.
And Mike said it, and that's one of the things. Were they doing the math? I don't know. Because it sounded like Devin Singletary could have been ready to play against New England. They didn't. They held him off, and now he's not ready to go against Tennessee. Obviously, the bye week may have played a factor into that. And quite frankly, Frank Gore's play may have played it. But if it's like a soft, you know, when it's a soft tissue issue or something like that, why rush it? Why not just hold up? Give yourself that extra week. Now you got 2 extra weeks to get out better, and especially the offensive line absolutely needs that same thing going on as well. You know, it makes sense why they didn't play Singletary, but boy, it felt like they could have used him a couple times.
On the other side, I was really enjoying this afternoon the Twitter back and forth between Tennessee Titans tackle Taylor Lewan and the Bills defensive lineman Shaq Lawson and Jordan Phillips. Who has been a bit of a revelation since kind of being forced into action with the Harrison Phillips injury. And he had 3 sacks yesterday. And I give Lewan credit for being able to go online and try to talk trash to two guys that just straight up dominated him and his teammates for 4 quarters. That was a great game. And Lawson, who continues to, I think, in a contract year, maybe not a stat sheet filler, but he has been finally kind of what we've been waiting for in that regard. He has been causing pressure, making quarterbacks rush their throws. He has a couple of hurries and hits and sacks, and it's been great. And the clips were getting shared earlier too, and you look at, he's right in the middle of all those sacks for Phillips too, causing the pressure inside, forcing Mariota to try to roll outside directly into Phillips. I'm to the point with Lawson where, and I wouldn't have said this before the season, I wouldn't mind trying to find maybe a more team-friendly deal. I don't think he's going to make a ton in the open market, but if he's willing to talk, I think I would like him to be part of this line if that's the kind of play that we're going to get from him.
It felt like the defensive line was just attacking in waves yesterday and really doing a nice job, because the Titans, at their heart, at their core, they want to run the ball. They want to be pounding you with Derrick Henry over and over and kind of softening you up for the second half. That has been their mentality. And there for a couple drives, it did seem like maybe they had a shot at being able to pull that off. But again, like you said, you know, the whole Taylor Lewan thing, he comes off of a 4-game suspension for PEDs, and he's talking a bunch of trash online and just self-owning himself.
Flexing during the game.
No end. He was talking shit during the game. He was getting called out by a bunch of players afterwards. And then all the Titans fans are like, well, you didn't do anything yesterday. You looked terrible. And then when you're citing Shaq Lawson's stats and trying to call him basically a first-round bust, then what did Shaq say? Beat your ass yesterday.
Yeah.
Sharing stats from 4 weeks that he didn't play because he was suspended.
Right. So Lewan
Lewan never got beat for a second.
Talk about a little bit of a paper tiger there. You know, and he is one of the highest-paid tackles in the league. He just got smoked yesterday. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Dude didn't play well. And we all have bad games, but boy, funny time to start talking shit when you're getting beat like that.
And also, and again, just the entire, it's the entire defense. The line certainly is the impetus of it, but you listen to Jordan Phillips in the postgame. He's quick to point out that they were able to get that much pressure because there was nothing open for Mariota downfield. Levi Wallace continues to be another revelation, really, on the outside. I don't think that anyone expected him to be quite as good as that complement to Trey White when you thought that was going to be E.J. Gaines' spot before E.J. Gaines got inevitably injured again. But Wallace has stepped in admirably, and at this point, I mean, the defense is going to be able to compete with every offense in the NFL.
And they can even, you know, they can weather, like the Harrison Phillips injury, they can weather some of these problems that they have, and they have the depth. Yeah, even the E.J. Gaines thing, like you said, E.J. was probably the second cornerback on this team in the preseason before he goes down with an injury. So, yeah, they're able to continuously hold up, and because of I really do think, I have to say, I think a lot of it is the scheme, and the scheme deserves the credit because the players are comfortable in it. We're seeing what happens more and more as players are more comfortable in what they do. When they don't believe in what they're doing out on the field, it shows. And now we're looking at a team that, not, of course, these guys are talented, but I also think they're just being put in the right spots. And by being put in the right spots, they're able to make the plays. Everybody's happy. It's just a cyclical thing.
I mean, it's players fitting a scheme, fitting the players.
Yep, absolutely.
But that's what Rex Ryan couldn't do with this team when he tried to move them around in the 3-4 and all that. You got McDermott using the players he has in ways that are good and comfortable to them, and they're responding.
Steve Berman was filming a special across the studio audience, and he came over here, and he's now going to be talking about football. Steve, welcome.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good.
How was the bowling?
Okay.
Did you win?
No.
Did you lose?
I bowled okay. I led the team for not having bowled in 6 months, but our team lost.
Oh, humble okay. brag.
No personal victories. Yeah. We lost.
There's no, you leave it out on the
There's
lane.
There's no I in bowling. There actually is, but.
What was the oil pattern tonight? Was it a shark?
A house pattern. Come on now.
Is it a anaconda?
No, it's a house pattern.
House pattern. So it's the shape of a house? Is that how it looks?
Yeah.
Okay. Sweet. Very good.
Kind of like a pencil or like a roof of a house.
Child's house.
Buffalo's premier bowling podcast here. Mm-hmm. That's right. Sports podcast.
You guys brought this up. I didn't say a word about it. Did you guys talk about the quality of the win? Because my point coming in about the Bills, and I'm just going to interject this.
Go ahead.
People are talking about the quality of the win, that it wasn't good. Well, they have a few wins that weren't necessarily high quality. But at some point, it's not luck and it's not like coincidence. At this point, it's almost like this team might win 10 games this year and they might all be ugly. And that's okay. Like, if this team is 0-4 and they win on Sunday, it's like, oh man, they scrounged out an ugly win. When you've done it three times already this year, that might just be your MO, and that's okay. Like, at some point, your narrative of they're not going to keep winning like this goes out the window because they do.
Do you know what the opposing kickers' percentage is this year against the Buffalo Bills?
Really bad.
2 for 8.
Do you know what the extra point percentage is?
Really bad.
4 for 8?
6 of 8.
6 for 8, sorry.
So
including 4 misses inside 50 yards. It's bananas.
75% extra point rate and a 25% field goal rate. I don't have an answer for it. I don't understand it. But it is a fact that it is happening. Is it the Bills or is it the kickers? I tend to think it's more the kickers, and they've kind of gotten lucky. But we were talking in the before the show was beginning. How can Mike Vrabel send Santos out there, having missed 3 kicks, one of which was just in real time within 10 to 15 minutes of being blocked or at least tipped, and then throw him out there down 7 for a 50-plus yard field goal, in which if he makes it, you still have to go score a touchdown to win the game? How?
It's the equivalent of Doug Marrone punting from inside the Pittsburgh 40, the game that Stevie dropped the touchdown in the end zone.
One of my favorite things to see is when a team is down 21 or a team is down 28 and the coach decides to kick a field goal to keep the team down 3 scores or keep the team down 4 scores. What are you doing? What wide receiver gains 8 hit points by automatically seeing their kicker kick a field goal and think, all right, now we're on the board. Here we go.
Now we got this.
The time has come.
Finally, we're within striking distance.
It just doesn't make sense to me. I mean, what a cowardly decision. And the Titans, who have always played the Bills and always done cowardly things. This is the team 3 years ago that punted twice inside the Bills 40 and lost in Tennessee because Ken Whisenhunt decided to punt from the 39 twice.
Imagine the Titans with like a Sean McVay kind of coach.
I literally cannot.
The state of Tennessee would implode.
The Rams make sense because they had the greatest show on turf, and it just like I get that. I have no idea what a potent Tennessee Titans offense would look like. I don't understand.
Neither do they, because it hasn't existed since Steve McNair.
Chris Johnson was fun.
Yeah, he was fun. That's true. But I mean, that was just give the ball to Chris Johnson and watch him run places. Right.
Yeah.
Kerry Collins came in at one point. He was subbing in for Vince Young, and they went 13-3 for a weird season. This is the team that signed Ronnie Tannehill to back up Marcus Mariota in the offseason. I don't know what it is, man. This is broken. Matt Hasselbeck was there for a little bit. The Titans are truly, to me, the most anonymous team in the NFL now. The Jaguars at least have the whole Duval thing. They got Gardner Minshew. They got Jalen Ramsey, good and bad. They have all those sort of things. I just don't know what are the Titans? What do they represent? What do you think of when you think of Titans football? You think of 8-8, 9-7. You think of Jeff Fisher from all those years ago.
Albert Haynesworth.
There's nothing there. The stadium's generic. Yeah. The uniforms look like high school uniforms now. What is the personality of that team? And I love Marcus Mariota at Oregon. God, he was so much fun. And he's just generic quarterback number 18 at this point.
The Titans are an 8-8 team with like the 17th best offense and the 15th best defense. They're going to go second place in their division somehow. And there's just nothing extraordinary or terrible about them. They just exist as a barometer for other football teams. If you beat them, you're a good team. If you lose to them, you're a bad team.
And if
you tie them, then you are them.
Yeah, and it's just always the same thing.
And it feels like it's been that way since Malarkey originally took over, at least.
The NFL was a house, they'd be beige paint.
Yeah. We sit in this beige painted room.
I was talking to my wife last night after Indy won, and that made the Bills win so much bigger.
Yep.
Because now it buries Tennessee a little bit. Houston won as well. Who's going to win that South Division? But if the Bills lose, then Tennessee's 3-2, Indy's 3-2, and Buffalo's 3-2, and things got a lot more muddy.
Yeah, and Baltimore instead, too.
It's Buffalo 4-1, Indy 3-2, Titans 2-3.
Yep.
And that's a huge advantage for the Bills.
And we were talking about that, and I don't know if there's six good teams in this conference this year. And I think the Bills are one of the teams that I don't have to worry about. So, yeah, it's pretty fun.
You got, correct me if I'm wrong, but don't you have two division leaders right now, either at 3-2?
Yeah, the Texans, and we're going to project the Ravens here at this point. And then you got the Chiefs at 4-1 and the Patriots 5-0.
I mean, you could have a situation where the Bills are conceivably better than whoever wins either the South or the West.
It's a nice position to be in if you have a better record than the opponent, even if you got to go to their place.
San Diego, the
Bills are 3-0 on the road.
We're 5 weeks into a season, so let me not assume that the Buffalo Bills are going to make the playoffs. However, with what's coming up the next 2 weeks, not having to play a game and then having to play again against Miami, I'm fairly confident this team will get to 5-1 before we have to have a discussion about it. So it feels good. And they are in the bye next week. That's about, you know, the team, they have a lot of things that they need to get healthy on, especially in that offensive line. Singletary, I will assume, will be at full go. I actually think he may be like the featured guy on offense in the Miami game, just to kind of get his feet wet again. And
I mean, there's no reason to be beating Frank Gore into the ground against a Dolphins team that you should be comfortably ahead of.
Yep.
It should be all Singletary with Yeldon spelling him.
Yep. I agree.
And it would be a good time, too, to give Duke Williams and some of these other guys who don't necessarily get a bunch of the looks.
What's Robert Foster looking like at this point? Is he coming back anytime soon?
I don't know. But if it'll be a good time to get a lot of work on the outside.
Get that Lee Smith train going for another couple touchdown
catches.
Shout
out to Lee Smith, who got a touchdown this week.
Lee Smith and Duke Williams, the two touchdown recipients, just like we all drew it up in the rafters.
Who would have thunk it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Lee Smith had enough time. I mean, he still almost didn't catch that ball.
Nope.
But he had
fought with that ball the entire way.
Yeah, he did.
It came down.
I was surprised he didn't screw it up.
The only reason he went to the ground was to help him catch the ball.
Yeah, 100%. Like, there was no
he wanted all of his
of
body under the ball to make sure that it never hit the turf.
He thought the ball was a blocker. He was trying to block it. Yeah. And alas, the blocker blocked him.
But in his natural stance, he actually held it instead, and that really helped him complete the catch.
It was a beautiful moment.
And shout out to Duke Williams, who looked to be about as excited as you would imagine anyone who has had a claw's way from the CFL to the NFL to beat to score his first NFL touchdown, running over to the Bills fans, taking pictures with them after the game.
He was having a good time.
And then the picture is A sitting at the end of the offensive line bench by himself while literally the entire offensive unit is at the other side of the bench talking, celebrating, and he's sitting by himself. It's like the kid at lunch that no one sits with, and you feel bad, but part of me, and this is going to sound really cold, is like no one did that to him. He kind of...
Did Zaya even play yesterday?
One snap.
Really?
Excuse me. He literally took the field for one offensive snap yesterday. So
I think you saw the writing on the wall the second that Williams was called up instead of calling up a backup quarterback. Well, I guess that didn't really have to happen once Allen was cleared. But the second that Duke Williams comes up and plays well, he's got to be like, well, I'm not dumb. I kind of know where this is trending. And
I heard that he led the team with the 56 receptions last year, but he had something like 108 targets. Like,
yeah,
I get that. I get that some of them are in the dirt. I get that some of them are defended. But when you get thrown the ball over 100 times and you finish the season with 56 receptions.
Yeah.
It's just for numbers, 54 is 50%.
Yeah, something like that. It's even still just. And as we said
that's
last week, Bill,
pretty bad.
His MO in college was one drop his entire college career.
It's just, it isn't and what it is. So
no.
Kind of incredible. Well, that does it for Bill's talk. And like we said, they're on the bye next week. So 4-1.
Any score predictions for next week?
The
Bills win 0-0.
Yeah.
The Bills will not lose on Sunday. Bet everything you have on that line.
Take the under.
The table's 3, the fans 2.
Bunch of John Warrows in here. Very cool. Very good shtick.
We all should have bet our house on the under like Bill told us.
That's right.
We should have bet our
that
futures
the
on the under.
Cash of all time. Boy, that thing just.
Did you bet it?
No, I.
We should have all pooled our money together and bet $86 on the under.
38.5 was the under over under.
Holy cow!
Came in extremely comfortable.
Even if
they could have played played 8 quarters and they would not have reached 38.5 points.
With wind and rain on the banks of whatever river flows through downtown Nashville,
That was so comfortable that Santos makes all 4 kicks 14, and they still 7, hit the under.
That's 21 times 2 is 42.
Yeah, I'm just saying that they were not scoring.
They would have been close.
Yeah.
Would have gotten there eventually.
Well, two games, they would have been close. Barely gotten over.
Want to bring in our hockey expert now, Justin Erick. Justin, thanks for listening to us record the football portion. Let's talk about the Sabres as we watch them just conclude their last of their first 3 games, an overtime loss 4-3 against Columbus. But they salvaged the point there in the last few moments of the third period in order to get the loser point. But overall... Hey, 5 points and 6, I'll take it to start the season.
Feels good.
Sorry, I was watching the Sabres game.
No, I know.
You're good.
We had it handled. Do you want to talk more Titans-Bills, or are you good at this point, buddy?
You guys handled it.
All right, go on.
I haven't been there.
You have thoughts. Get them out.
They play good. They're a good hockey team.
They seem to be all right right now.
Oh, yeah, they look really well coached, and that's fun to watch. Like last year, they actually play defense now. As opposed to last year when the defensive zone was like a kind of a free-for-all and no one knew what they were really doing. But their forecheck is super aggressive and they keep really tight gaps. And they lost tonight against a super desperate Columbus team. Like, you had to expect them to come out flying, and they did. The Sabres struggled the first period. And the Sabres fanned on 2 passes, so apparently everyone watching the game said there's bad ice. So that was fun to watch the first period.
I mean, I didn't get to watch until we got over here. I was out earlier, but that was everybody in the within the first 5 minutes said both teams were really struggling with choppy ice.
I didn't look choppy. There's a couple guys fanned on passes, so then that meant there was bad ice, apparently. Ice looked fine to me.
Well,
anyway,
probably whatever great activities are going on in Columbus when there's not hockey, like a Rusted Root concert, right? I bet you they're huge.
Typical
there.
Sabres,
does sound about right.
Typical Sabres Twitter for the first period. We suck again.
Yep.
Everyone was panicking, and then
it's just like watching Major League.
Wait, it only took 7 periods for the world for everything to fall apart on the Sabres.
Yeah, they're fun to watch though. Again, what do you think, Steve?
So you can feel the difference. So you saw the breakaways that they earned and the odd man rushes they earned against Pittsburgh, and then in the building on Saturday, you saw forwards cheating. You know, like when it, I'm lazy because I'm fat. So when I play basketball, if I know that a three-pointer is going up, I start to take off the other way, because if we get the rebound, I'm going to be out. And it feels like the Sabres, a couple times, they start to feel like they're going to come up with the puck, and they take off. And then the defender either bounces it off the glass or tries a stretch pass, and I feel like Housley would be having a conniption that their forwards are cheating out to center ice, to the neutral zone, without possession of the puck. And I think that Kruger is telling him, no, like, get up there, take a chance, get it up and off the glass. Worst case scenario, it's an icing. Best case scenario, it's a breakaway. And we've seen how many breakaways. I didn't see much of the game tonight, but they're making a conscious effort to get the puck and skaters up the ice. And it doesn't feel like they are bound and determined to back check into oblivion. And sure, are you going to give up some goals that way? Yeah, but it's a lot more exciting hockey.
I mean, there were less of those breakaways, I feel like, tonight against Columbus than we had seen in the first two games. But I think the thing that goes part and parcel with that is that the defense is doing a much better job of getting the puck up the ice to the forwards. Yeah. That was such an issue last year. The defenders not able to get the puck out of their own zone, getting trapped back there. Terrible turnovers from basically everyone wearing a Sabres jersey in their own defensive zone. But it doesn't feel like, at least through three games, that has been as much of an issue. You had the one turnover in overtime, but that's 3-on-3. That's a little bit different, where Foligno takes the puck away in the corner. And then that allows you to do things like send your forwards up the ice, or it allows Jeff Skinner to try to get a stick in and steal a puck away that leads to the second goal. It gives you so much more flexibility as a forward group, and it feels like, it for a group that has two new faces in it, it feels like an entirely fresh group of players out there. You can almost not recognize some of these guys out there based on how well they've played through nine periods plus of hockey.
But like you were saying, too, having that defensive presence to move the puck up ice, and we've seen it with guys like Dahlin and Joki Haru and Miller, and once you add Brandon Montour to this group, and it seems like everybody right now, very early, small sample size, whatever, they seem to be comfortable with what they're doing. They seem to stick with it all throughout. It does seem to be more attacking, more pressing. I mean, they're putting up numbers so far. Haven't scored less than three goals in any of these games, which, my God, when was the last? It doesn't feel like the Buffalo Sabres score three goals in three straight games very often these days. It feels like it's been a while. I'm sure they've done it, but that is the mentality that you'd like to see from a hockey team, and that's the type of thing where you can create. And you also have to have guys that can complete the passes on the other end, too. And they do. They have good forwards. These, you know, Sheary looked amazing in Pittsburgh. And then you still got guys like Eichel and Skinner, who's looking like he's on pace for another great season with the scoring. You know, the middle stat group is struggling right now. I think that's probably been actually the weakest point, because even the scrubs, they haven't been that bad.
I think the Larson-Gergensen-Zapoza line has been fantastic.
They haven't been that bad.
They've been the most consistent, for sure.
They may not be potting the goals quite as well as the top two, but I think they've looked great out there.
The first game, that line of Middlestat's line was the best line on the ice that game, and they've been kind of visible ever since.
Yeah, that is true. They did play well in Pittsburgh, but the games against Jersey and Columbus, not so much.
Justin, you want to own one of your very correct takes about Victor Olofsson on the power play?
Oh, everyone was really angry on Twitter, and I was swearing in my house. Like, my wife was like, "What the fuck are you swearing about?" And because they didn't have Olofsson on that point, and he was in the middle, and I think it was like they showed him all preseason on that left point ripping the puck, and I think they put him in the middle there as a wrinkle to catch the Penguins off guard, and I think they did, because you know ever since he's been on that point. I tell you, and then something you didn't see out of last year's, you know, little game plans like that to throw a team off. It looks like you're going to game plan more individually, and you're going to see much out of Housley's coaching staff, I feel like.
To build off of that point, another thing that has worked really well for the power play, and we saw it again tonight in the game tying goal, is the ability of having Olofsson and Eichel on opposite sides of that top power play unit, because Jack loves moving that puck right across and feeding Olofsson. And I feel like it has shifted a little bit of the weight of the defense away from Jack Eichel, because you can't shade too heavily to Eichel if you got a guy who can rip the puck like Victor Olofsson on the other side. And the power play unit has been very good so far, and it feels like it's going to be a big strength for this team again. I mean, special teams are going to peak and valley throughout the course of the season, but that is a top five that, if they keep playing this well, it could be one of the best power play units just in terms of pure puck movement and skill, when you got Eichel, Skinner, Dahlin, Olofsson, and Reinhardt all having kind of unique roles in what they're great at. And the ability of Dahlin to be the lone defenseman out there at the point and handle the blue line, which gives you the ability to have both Skinner and Reinhardt out there on the shift as well, is another big thing. I think that Olofsson is looking every bit as we hoped he would through three games. Again, sample size, admittedly small. I thought the same thing about him last year when he was up. I thought about him in Rochester. He has looked like he belongs right there next to Jack Eichel on the top line, which, of course, also gives you the ability to do something we weren't sure if they were going to be able to do, which is play Jeff Skinner and Jack Eichel on separate lines. And so far, the returns on that have been very positive.
You know, he has a really, really good shot, obviously, and quick release. But I think one of the most underrated things about his shot is his shot selection. Like, he's never picking bad shots or where to shoot them. I mean, like, that goal that last goal he had tonight was a perfect place. Great shot. I don't know. He's going to score 30 goals this year, man.
He's on pace for now 3 goals in 3 games. That's a pretty good start for that.
I'll take it. Yeah, for sure. And that power play is scary. Like, whenever they get, so far this year, when they go in the power play, I'm like, they're going to score. Like, I assume they're going to score every time.
Yeah, they definitely look more comfortable, and it is such an advantage, and teams can really ride a great power play, and it kind of just opens everything else up, because then teams get just a little bit more cautious about facing, you know, and tend to play a little bit more on their heels. And I think that's such an advantage that if you can take advantage of it. And then there are, so look, the Sabres, they're not going to be quite as fast as we want them to be, especially with some of the bottom six forwards and everything like that. But I do think that they're a good combination. I think they can go a little bit heavier with the checking line, or whatever we want to call it, the fourth line with Gergensens and Larson and Nakpo. So it's kind of the bigger line. And then you got the guys that really can offer the speed up at top with guys like Eichel and Olofsson and Reinhart and those guys. So it's a good mix of what they can offer at this point, and the returns have been good so far. Tonight was Linus Ullmark's debut on the season. Getting the overtime loss. I thought Hutton looked pretty comfortable the first two games. I thought he actually looked really good in Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. Didn't need to be as good against Jersey, but was fine. Serviceable.
Yeah, I mean, a bad goaltending that might have really shifted the paradigm of that game early on, but he was good when he had to be, and then yep. Later on in the game it didn't matter because they were so comfortably in control by the end of that second period.
Ullmark played very well tonight.
I thought he was excellent tonight.
39 saves and 42 shots.
I think he got a little bit hung out to dry a couple times, unfortunately.
Ullmark goals were pretty lucky, in my opinion. That first goal was so lucky. He took a perfect bounce off the boards, and then as he flails like a back position and hits his blocker.
Foligno, the third goal for Columbus to go ahead, same thing where you were just like, that is
the situation. Is Jack trying to do too much, or did Foligno make a really great play in the puck? A little bit of both.
I think it was half,
Foligno that he made a really, he read what Jack was going to do, with the puck and put his stick there and scooped it away. And
I mean, at this point, Foligno is the best forward on the team, right?
Yeah. That Tesha guy was really good, too. It felt like he had the puck all game, like Jeff said earlier.
Yeah, he was all over the place. There's a lot of potential on there, but obviously they're missing the guys they built around last year, and Panarin and Duchesne and all those guys who have all moved on to maybe not greener, but different pastures, at least. It's a team it's one of those teams that it's a good measuring stick for the Sabres. I think Pittsburgh and New Jersey are teams that are not going to make the playoffs this year. Columbus is a team that I could see being in that fringe contention somewhere between 7 and 10. So I think it bodes well for the Sabres that they went into Nationwide tonight against a team that was playing motivated because they had lost their first two games. And I think this was Buffalo's worst game of the season so far. But worst game of the season doesn't mean bad game. I think they played well. Columbus dominated the last 5 minutes of the first period. Buffalo came back, responded well, had a very good second period. It's a great individual goal by Skinner. It's such a great play to take that puck away from Murray and just rifle it in like that. Then they have some more adversity. There's that Foligno goal on the power play in the third period. They don't give up. They pull the goalie very early, very aggressive goalie pull with almost 3 full minutes left. Keep him pulled for the power play. Olofsson gets that goal. That is a great, gritty road point. And you have taking some points like that, they're going to add up. If you can keep yourself in games, obviously you hope that they win that game in overtime or a shootout. But I'm happy with everything I've seen from this team so far.
And the first period was their worst period. And the Jackets were out flying. And I think they were playing scared of their coach. I mean, the first game, they're up 4-0 and then end up losing. Or no, I got that backwards, right?
Thinking in New Jersey.
Yeah, my bad. The second game, they lose
7-2 to Pittsburgh.
7-2 to Pittsburgh. And that's an angry John Tortorella. I think they came up flying today. And they managed to get a point. And they, at times, they played well throughout the second and third. But at times, Ullmark definitely bailed them out. But
never held the lead,
for a
though,
bad game. It wasn't that bad of a game. I'll take that every day, every bad game.
Yep, you got to just take it because sometimes getting a point on the road against a team that has a different motivation than you do, you know, that's okay.
And you're almost never going to complain about going on the road and getting a point, even against a quote-unquote bad team.
In your first two road games now.
Yep. Yeah, I think that's pretty good.
Not going to complain about 5 points out of six.
Nope.
Not especially if you keep stringing like say like groups of three games. Get 5 points here, four on this one, maybe three on this one, another four, another three, five. It all keeps adding up, and it adds up well.
Yep.
Now, this is all the Sabres' great start is kind of looped in with a couple other encouraging things that I've seen so far in the division. Toronto blew a big lead to Montreal on Saturday, so they're definitely not untouchable. Their defense and goaltending is still huge question mark.
Hey, imagine that. The Leafs have trouble on the blue line.
Mm. See that?
Who would have thunk it?
You can roll 12, 50 goal scorers, and they still just, they don't have a whole lot back there.
Cody Ceci and Tyson Barrie are going to move that puck really well, but they are missing guys like, they're missing Jake Gardner. They're missing guys like
three people
that.
Said Morgan Riley was going to win the Norris this year on the ESPN previews. And I said, and my friend's like, well, yeah, because he's going to get 70 points because he's playing on a team. I said, I get that. There's not a chance in hell, though. And then four or five people said Freddie Anderson for Vezina. Like,
what?
Man, I don't see it. And I just... Sure.
To be clear, that loss to Montreal was 6-5.
They're going to be playing in a lot of those games. Mm-hmm. Like when they lose, they're going to lose many games this year where they score four goals.
I mean, even that opener they had against Ottawa was back and forth until they pulled away a little bit. Ottawa was potting some good shots against them.
Brady Tkachuk scored like 14 seconds into the game, didn't he?
Well, welcome to the season, there, Freddie Anderson. Yep. Here's your Vezina campaign trait. We're going to start with that shot. And you got that. You have the Lightning, who yesterday didn't have a single shot against Carolina for an entire period,
man,
and then lost to Carolina.
They're still recovering from Columbus shit pumping them last year.
Columbus broke them.
But wasn't it like 12 shots in the first period and then like nothing in the second and one in the third?
Yeah,
it was insane. Wow. Now they don't have Braden Point, but not. He's not the main catalyst, though. They have
doesn't help, but
the
reigning
Hart Trophy winner. I know.
There's no excuse for them. And Pittsburgh, who's a team that put up seven on Columbus. So this is a team that is now without Malkin and
Bukestad
for both long term, probably at least a month plus.
Being
this is one of those
very
teams that's be
coy
competing
about what it is. No, saying that it's not season ending, but long-term.
They both call them longer term injuries.
Yes. So. There's some
Malkin's
issues.
Believed to be at least a month, and Buke said I did not hear an update.
And look, all their guys are in their mid-30s now, like all their stars. So they're not a team that is being led. There's not much of a youth revolution going on in Pittsburgh.
This is kind of like their last go at
How
it.
Much of Pittsburgh's roster can be compared to Chicago the past couple of years? You have the big-name talent.
Sure.
With Letang, Malkin, and Crosby, and... then some supplemental talent, but overall, the rest of the lineup, like, how many NHL fans know who Dominic Simone is? He plays every shift on Crosby's wing.
They're very weak. They have so much money committed to so few guys. And that was part of, essentially Malkin and Kessel were feuding with each other, and that was one of the reasons, I think, why they moved Kessel out. And of course, that's the guy that you would... that he would push out. I don't blame him for that one. But yeah, I mean, it was a it's a real thing for Pittsburgh now. So there is some, early returns here in the East. There will be some good teams, but I don't know who's coming out of this conference at this point. You tell me who's the best team. I guess it's again, very, very early on. Toronto will be there.
Undefeated Detroit Red Wings.
Yeah, right. Anthony Mantha, man.
What a hell of a game.
Four goals yesterday.
Unbelievable.
Incredible. I mean, of course, we know that things will check this out. Of course, Tampa is going to turn... I mean, Tampa, for their own sanity, should turn it around.
But, like, the teams that we thought for sure were going to be up there, like, are we for sure that Tampa and Toronto are going to be 1 and 2 in this division? They probably will be, but, I mean, maybe Boston's better than both of them. Maybe one of those teams falls down a bit.
Like, who's really good in the Metro?
There's no one who's actually dominant in
really
the Metro.
Good.
Capitals are still very good.
They're probably the best team in it.
It's probably the Capitals. I would still put...
It honestly might be the Hurricanes.
The Devils, if the Devils figure out, the Devils have a lot of talent. They just got to put it all together.
That's true.
Blackwood can do.
If I had to bet on one, out of this group of eight, tell me who's going to win this, I would probably put my money on the Capitals to win the division.
If the odds were interesting, I think... I do think Washington's the best team in that division. But if you told me at the end of the season that Carolina wins that division,
know,
I'm not sure.
I know. It's certainly within the realm. And then obviously we know Toronto, Tampa, and Boston, and they've all come out to, you know, varying results. Boston's won their first two. Like we said, Tampa, a weird game against Carolina. And Toronto losing 1 point off of Montreal because of some inability. So they've already played four, and they only got 5 points out of that. So, hey, there's obviously a lot of hockey to go, but it just feels good to be talking about this,
right?
Really,
and
again,
the point of the standings conversation is that it actually feels like the Sabres team is worth comparing to other teams in the conference at this point. It has been a while since I felt like the Sabres team was playing well enough, other than that win streak last year. And even then, you were like, is this team really this good, or are they getting this many one-goal close wins?
Well, and that's the thing, is that they're not doing all these by one goal, yeah, right?
Like this team feels like it is owning more games.
Already than what we've talked about before.
Well, Steve and I watched the end of the third period of the Pittsburgh game together on Wednesday or Thursday, mm-hmm. and he told me after the game, it was like Buffalo just went right into Pittsburgh and they dominated the Penguins for 60 minutes, yeah. and it felt like they were the better team from the word go. They were better team against New Jersey from the word go. I mean, this is a team that, if they can continue to play this way, now we've seen flashes of this in the past, so I'm a little scared to open myself up to the possibility and get my heart broken again by this hockey team. But it feels like there's things in place and things are looking like this could be a team that is actually good.
They look comfortable out there. And that's the big thing I'm thinking about. Let's not look at stats. Let's not look at analytics or anything. Let's just look at the eye test. They look comfortable out there. They look like they know what they're doing out there. They look like they're just playing the game, reacting to what's out there. They know how to handle it themselves. And instead of being overcoached, it's like the coaching staff trusts them to do their thing out there. And basically, if they keep playing like that, I think this team is going to be a lot better than they were last year and is going to be this exciting almost every game this season. Obviously, they're going to have off days, but I think they're going to be a very exciting team to watch and at worst in almost every game this year.
And they look bought into the system, and that's really mm-hmm. important. They look very confident. Great point. And, you know, one of the things after last year, you know, it wasn't a great year, but after last year, they learned that they're able to come from behind. So even tonight when they were behind, they didn't look panicked. They looked very calm and composed, and they came back and tied it in the very last 10 minutes.
Yeah, they didn't look desperate. They were just kind of running through the system.
In the last 2 minutes, they were all very calm, communicating. Yep. And I feel promising about this team. And I feel confident in the coaching staff as opposed to Housley. And they never had a real identity under Housley. And I feel like you could already see one under
with our untrained eye, we know what they're trying to do, and you could see them execute it, and it works. You mentioned the system, Justin, and the buy-in, and Jake McCabe said that in the midst of practices or drills, there is freedom to make a move with the puck. Like he said, we have talented players here, and they're allowed to be creative. Mm-hmm. And I also heard, and I think I was talking to Jeff about this, maybe not, that Kruger runs a drill like no more than 3 times. So when you show up to practice, you're not doing the same thing 20 times. He basically says to them, you have 3 times, do it right, because you're not going to do it anymore. So perfect it in your 3 runs. But the other part of it is, like, if I was going to practice a sporting event and I knew I was about to do the same drill 20 times, I'd be like, all right, well, here we go. You're only going to have 3 times to do it, and then you're doing something else. Maybe it's because we're, you know, young, stupid, we have no work ethic people, but...
It's
a real thing. When
training.
You know that you're not about to run, you know, suicides for the entire hour, you know that things are going to be fresh and new. It's kind of twofold. One, you're not bored at practice. And two, the exact words that the Buffalo News used in the article was they have three attempts to perfect it. So in other words, get it right. You don't have a lot of time to fix things. I don't know. I do agree that they're buying into the system, Justin, but I think a lot of it is because the system allows them to be more creative, allows them to, you know, it's not do it this way and there's no other right way to do it. I don't know.
3-game homestand coming up here in the next week. Got the Canadiens, the Panthers, and the Stars in the matinee on Columbus Day. And then after that, first West Coast swing, they get the Ducks, Kings, and Sharks out there. 3 games in 4 nights.
Win all of those games.
Yep. I mean,
possible.
This is a game plan. I agree. You
know, this is a good time to
Sharks get 0-3, by the way.
This is a good time for them to get the West Coast swing because usually,
I love having the
traditionally, the California teams all right, start slow.
Yeah. Well, they're living up to the. I mean, Los Angeles only played a game, so not really fair to judge.
It's a crazy game against Edmonton. Only 6-5.
Yeah, but we got, you know, it. Look, you got two division games coming up against Montreal and Florida. Handle your business. Dallas is off to a slow start as well. So yeah, more favorable chances to bank some points. And we talked about it during that win streak last year, but that almost felt like try and get as many as you possibly can here because we're not sure how long this is going to last. This looks like something that is at least sustainable. And
right,
of course, they can still finish, I don't know, 11th in the East. But I see three good teams, and only one of them is even off to a decent start
right now in the conference. Even if they finish 11th this year, would you agree that it looks like it'll be a competitive 11th instead of
that's what I need
falling,
to see.
Yeah. Instead of just falling out of games and just seeing 5-2 losses and
right.
pile up?
And there's going to be a four-game streak where they score, you know, 5 goals in those 4 games and lose. And yes, we will get frustrated again, but for right now, the early returns are. And even if it's the new coach bump, this looks pretty good right now.
You know the best part about the game today? Is that by the end of the game, Jimmy Vesey was moved up to Sabaka's spot.
This happened, folks.
Good news.
The Sabaka news.
Don't know why.
I'm waiting to hear that he's getting
that a plane ticket. That is Sabaka's spot, by the way.
I just feel like the Sabres already look pretty good, and I don't feel like the lineup's even maximized yet. I just feel like there's still so much more they can do to get more out of this team.
I mean, they're missing at least two or three guys they thought were going to be starting defensemen on this team, and Montour, maybe Pilot, and Bogosian. The defensive room looks really deep right now, by the way, considering how well Marcus Gandel has played through 3 games.
Just say earlier, is Corsi's laughably high?
It's laughably high. It looks ridiculous. Like, he was a really good defender in Minnesota, and I don't know, maybe it was just Halsey's system or what it was. But he was really bad the last couple of years. And now, again, the first 3 games. And again, sample size, I realize. But he has been excellent. He and Yogi Haru have both been fantastic.
I think how this system asked for the defenders to look for a lot of offense, which is probably why they were so scrambly. And I think Scandella was too worried about creating offense and creating a transition. That's just my theory on it, because he looks way better when he's just playing defense this season.
All I know is that if this is what this Sabres team with this personnel is capable of, then Phil Housley should never get hired to coach an NFL team ever again.
NHL. I still...
But he shouldn't be hired to coach an NFL team either.
I still want to see
NBA or MLB.
I still want to see Skinner back with Jack. And maybe Reinhardt off Jack's line, because I feel like Skinner just looks so bogged down when he's not with Jack, because Eichel just naturally creates so much more space for him, and he's able to use all his edge work, and he's got so much more room to maneuver. He just looks so bogged down out there with Johansson and Sabatka.
Well, Sabatka looks like he's bogging down everybody, so.
Drain
you
the
guys, you guys ever see him smile? He never smiles.
Sabatka?
Yeah.
Well, you listen to the podcast, and he knows you don't like him.
That's it.
Words hurt, Justin.
He knows there's five guys in a room that just want to see him gone or something.
If this is the only 5 guys in a room he's going to deal with, he is having a great week. I've heard 18,000 guys in a room boo him before.
We just have him call into the show on time.
Oh, that did not work. Well, I wonder if the Sabres are going to give us back our press credentials after the Tage Thompson interview.
We should see if we can get any of the other guys' cell phones.
Yeah, see what we can do.
Henry Yokiharu. To work on that accent.
You sure do there, Bill. Yeah. He does, whoever that is. Yeah.
All right. Anything else? I think that just about does it.
Shout out to the Buffalo Buttes winning their first game of the year on the road to Connecticut on Saturday.
Fort Butte.
They are home not this upcoming weekend, but the following Saturday, the 19th.
That's correct.
The originals. 11:30
a.m., I believe, is that face-off.
It is bright and early. Get yourself some waffles. Watch some hockey.
I would not trust waffles from the Northtown Center concession stand.
Probably want to bring your own waffles, honestly.
Weirdest popcorn I've ever tasted in my life from there.
Yeah?
Yep.
Steve enjoys it.
It's super good.
And I'm sure that they've improved it from Fort Butte. Are you serious?
I love it.
Oh, God. I think it's terrible.
Really?
It's... What is it that you like about it?
I don't know. I couldn't tell you.
It tastes like pure artificial butter.
Yeah, then maybe that's what... Nailed it, Bill. You just described to me why I like it so much. It's like licking Blue Bonnet.
Yeah. I think we've all dreamt about that.
Everything's better with Blue Bonnet on it.
Yeah.
Nice.
Sure.
You ask me why I like it, I say, I don't know. You say what it tastes like, I'm like, that's it.
There it is.
There's the winner.
Archie blows.
So
you jogged your memory.
Are they really, they're really doing the Fort Butte thing?
That appears to be a real thing.
It was a cool graphic. Right. That was a really cool graphic on Twitter.
It was a graphic.
It was a cool graphic. I thought it was good.
I liked it. People had an issue with the font, apparently.
But I just had an issue with how poorly Photoshopped that flag was.
Was it in Comic Sans? People hate that.
People do hate
Comic Sans.
I'm up there with Windings, the most hated fonts.
Windings was such a weird font because nobody even knew what it was saying. And they're like, here's a default font. But even back in the day when it was like 18 fonts, that was the one. Helvica.
It was emojis before we had them.
I go Calabri 11. This is a good, you feel good about
Times
yourself.
Times New Roman saves ink. Yeah. Times New Roman is the most efficient on an office printer as far as ink usage
anymore.
I'm telling you, we have to save the planet, Bill. And Times New Roman uses less.
I got other things I'm doing to save the planet. I don't need to have my.
Also, the reason for the removal of the Oxford comma, which drives me nuts. But
I'm gonna use that. They can pry the Oxford comma.
You would think a sans serif font would work better for saving ink, but
Times New Roman is the most efficient at toner,
like Arial or Tahoma or something like that.
This has been Font Talk with the 716 Sports Podcast.
So Fort Butte.
A real place where hockey will be played.
With sketchy popcorn.
Mike's been handling UB on the weekends. They're a little bit of a mixed bag so far. They're playing good teams, ranked teams. I give them credit for scheduling three consecutive ranked opponents to start the season in non-con.
That's like me in NCAA football 14 trying to get that power rating up.
But I think the good part to that is when that team gets to conference play, the last couple of years, they've been so far ahead of everyone else in their conference that I think that really builds the team going into conference play
again. It's the Gonzaga method.
Basically, they're going to schedule all these teams, but I don't think any of those teams are going to hold a candle to them when it comes to turn for regular season conference play. They got a bit before that still.
It's fine.
And then we'll have other fun stuff coming up here in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, 2-3 right now does they're 2-3 right now doesn't go towards their conference schedule. So
every single team that they have played is ranked 20th or higher in the country.
That's very legitimate. So. Yep, good for them.
So thanks for listening, everyone. You can find this podcast and other podcasts that we have made on Facebook at 716 Sports Podcast, on Twitter at 716 Sport Podcast, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, wherever you prefer to plug your podcasts into your ear holes. We'll be back next week recapping an exciting Bills game against the bye week and recapping another week of Buffalo Sabres hockey. Until then, guys, thanks for listening. We'll see you soon.